I know she's here. Mr. Murphy?
Present.
And Kathy's not quite here yet. I don't see Ms. Lloyd yet. No? Ms. Sutter?
I'm here.
Mr. Hales?
I'm here.
And Mr. Fraley?
I'm here. I think we do have barely a quorum. Thank you, folks, for everyone being here. My hat's off to the vice chair for filling in for me last month. Appreciate that, Matt. Thank you. And we'll get right into our agenda.
Okay, so to the first public hearing item, this is Virginia Supportive Housing. It is an existing structure and use located at 2425 Gosnold Avenue. It's on the west side of Gosnold Avenue between 24th and 25th. It is essentially apartments for the formerly homeless. They are living here now. And they are proposing to amend the conditions to allow more units. Next slide. So as I mentioned, they're existing. The use is there now. In May of 2005, that's when they started, about 15 years ago, a little bit more, the property was rezoned to IN, which is institutional, by this applicant, to allow for a 61 single occupancy efficient apartments, a full-time residential manager, and facility that includes laundry, community room, kitchenettes, staff offices, and a parking across Gosnold. So the reason the applicant is here today is because it was a conditional rezoning and it held the number of units to 61. They are proposing an additional 40 units and then an additional one for the staff member that stays there. So a total of 101 units. And this requires a conditional rezoning to modify that condition to increase the number. And all the other conditions that were put in place in 2005 remain the same. Next slide. This is the property here on the right side of the slide. That is their parking. And then on the left side, that is their building. What they're proposing to do is to add two additional stories to that rear part of the building, not the portion that is right on Gosnold, but the portion to the rear. And again, it would lead to a total of 101 units. Next slide. Oh, that's it. The conditions, and I'll go over these just because I think they're kind of important. They tell you a little bit about the operation. So we talked about it as a single occupancy only efficiency apartments, no resident requiring 24 supervision would be permitted as a resident. There shall be no more than 101 units. There shall be full-time night monitor who shall reside on premises. There shall be a front desk that shall be staffed 16 hours a day. No overnight guests shall be permitted. The facility shall contain laundry facilities, a community room with a kitchenette, and staff offices. The primary entrance to the building shall be on Gosnold with emergency exits on 24th and 25th. Parking, and this was, again, they have parking across the street, but this is an addition to the rezoning from last time. The parking lot will include signage stating it's a private parking lot, fencing, and a controlled access. The owner will maintain a contract with a towing company for unauthorized use of the parking lot. So that was to address some concerns the commissioners had. Each unit shall contain a full bathroom, kitchenette, including a stove and a refrigerator. 10% of the unit shall be fully handicap accessible. The property manager and a social worker will interview all prospective tenants. Screen will include criminal and credit background checks. All residents will be able to live independently. The following services shall be available to all tenants: case management, transportation assistance, job, vocational, and financial counseling, medical, dental, mental health, and or substance abuse treatment referral services. Two more. The building shall contain an extensive internal and external security camera system, exterior lighting, and an access control system to regulate entry to only permitted persons. And the last one is the facility will interact with the Community Services Board and other service providers. So that's a good sense of how they operate, and all of those conditions will follow with they were in the 2005, but they'll be in this conditional rezoning as well. I do want to let you know we did receive a letter of opposition from the Park Place Civic League. I think they had two issues. Number one, when this group came before them the first time, The Park Place agreed to it because they said, okay, but we don't want to see you back. And then they also feel that they have a high concentration of low to moderate income in the community already, and they're concerned about increasing it. So they were okay with the first time, but they are not supporting the second request for additional units. Any questions, Susan, I can answer on this one?
Susan, right now they can have 61 people?
Correct. It's 60 people plus one for the person that stays there.
And are they fully occupied, all those 60 units?
I'm sure they are if they're asking for more.
Wow. And do they house, did I hear you read in your comments there, they do address the needs of the mentally ill?
Yeah, they have counseling for that.
Okay. And have we had any incidents of any consequence that required authorities to go out?
Not that I'm aware of.
Questions, commissioners?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
You know, do they feel as though they are perhaps being singled out as a community in which this can be placed because many other communities would not accept such housing?
You're talking about Park Place?
Yeah.
Yeah, you'll have to talk to them about that.
Yeah.
Okay, because I was wondering if that was a motivation for them saying they did not want it there. But I mean, would we be, is this a temporary housing? It really is by definition temporary housing.
It is only supposed to be temporary. That is correct.
So is it in fact increasing the density of low to moderate income people? In other words, is it destroying the diversity of the neighborhood economically?
You know, all I can say is there's more rooms.
I mean, such housing is desperately needed.
Yeah.
And their other facility, I think you all know, is on Church Street, kind of at the railroad tracks, just to the north, I should say.
Yeah.
On the east side, excuse me. And I think they've got 81 there.
So what are we talking about in terms of distance? It's only a couple of miles, correct?
Yeah, I would say that's fair.
These are some interesting questions. You know, it's not an easy issue versus what the people there don't want and what is needed for this housing population.
Susan, are they going to be on the?
I'm sorry.
Are they
going
to be speaking in public forum?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the first part of that.
Susan, is Park Place specifically going to be on the call for the next meeting for the public hearing?
My understanding is they are going to come to the public hearing.
Okay, good. Because I know, you know, we all have some questions for them. Thank you.
And I'm checking you in, Ms. Lloyd.
Welcome, Amanda. Any more questions on this? Susan, how close is the nearest residential to single family detached or other?
So there's some multifamily. There's not a whole lot of single family near here.
Except for me.
Okay. Except for, yeah. Okay, like I said, who else? Thank you, Ken. Any other questions on this particular item, commissioners? We're on the Wave Express.
So that item is going to be continued. We got the word from the applicant on, I guess, last Friday. So this is the one that is on Ingleside, and they have that, you know, people call a city parcel. It's actually a city right-of-way. And so I think they are working with someone with the city to see if it's a possibility to close that street, to incorporate it into their site. So they asked for it to be continued until at least January.
Susan, this is sitting right there where in front of the bank, isn't it?
It is the bank. It's the old bank.
Okay. There's a street there? Yes, there is. Behind it. Yeah. Yes, there is.
So it's technically Princess Anne.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Katie's Kickers, I guess that's Joy.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. So this conditional use permit would allow for a home occupation with on-site service consultation and one employee who's not a member of the household. Next slide, please. The applicant would like to teach swimming lessons with one additional instructor at our home. Under SFT zoning, home businesses are permitted but require a conditional use permit when there is on-site service or consultation with customers. So essentially when customers are coming in or when you have an employee there who is not a member of the household. She is requesting to do both. The maximum number of, if approved, the maximum number of students that she is asking in her pool at any one time would be 8. And then the maximum number of instructors would be 2. For every 4 students, there will be at least 1 instructor present. Next slide, please. The applicant has 181 square foot in-ground pool, which was permitted in 2009. It is enclosed, as you can see with the from the photo, it is enclosed by a 6-foot high fence. All her instructors are first aid and CPR certified and have an American Red Cross lifeguarding certification. Any new instructors, if this is approved, any new instructors will be required to also be certified. Because the applicant is a military spouse and is not expected to remain at this location indefinitely, she is okay with and staff is recommending a 2-year expiration date. Next slide, please. Here we see an image of the neighborhood. The panel up top is the other single family homes across from her home, and then the panel to the south is the Catholic school, which is adjacent to her property. She does have a parking agreement with the school. And if approved, we will be requiring that that all her clients will be parking either here or on her property, but no right away will be utilized by any of her clients. Clients meaning the parents, of course. And that's it for this one. I'm available for questions.
Joy, when you say that her clients can't use the right of way, you're not saying that they can't park on the street, are you?
Yes, I am. No. I'm saying they can't park in the right of way. They can't park their vehicles in the right of way. They have to either park in the parking lot of the school, which she has an agreement with for her clients to use, or they have to park at her driveway. In fact, if we can go up one more slide, you'll see that she has a very long driveway. The parents stick around and watch as the children conduct their lessons.
And I see in the report that the Civic League is supportive of her project here.
Correct.
Any questions, commissioners?
On-street parking is otherwise permitted, correct?
It is, yes. But for her clients, we don't want to burden the neighborhood with additional cars.
Well, this is something too. She was working with her neighbor, and that was a concern of his because there was quite a few people and cars in the street, and she said, "Look, that's not normally what I intend to do. I intend for these folks to purely park on my lot or the lot next door." So this was something that she told us she wanted to do.
So this is primarily a warm weather activity, is it not, since we have an outdoor pool here?
Correct. It'll be seasonal. As a condition of approval, it'll be between March through November. And those are the months she provided for us.
Any questions, commissioners? Thank you, Joy. Susan, we're on the MetroNet.
Okay, so this site is located at 6242 Sewell's Point Road. It's just to the north of Five Points. the taxi place, I think everyone's familiar with that, is abuts the site right to the north. They are requesting a conditional use permit for a communication tower. Next slide. So the zoning is CC. Towers are permitted by conditional use permit in the CC district. Next slide. So this is the site plan. And MetroNet, by the way, is a new internet service that's coming to the city. They confirmed for us that this will be the only site that they need a tower for in Norfolk. So this is it. It will be fenced and landscaped and with a fence. The structures are both, there's two structures, 322 square feet both, and I believe it's a 79 foot tall tower, a little bit smaller than our average communication tower. Next slide, or is that it, I think? Yeah, that's it. This isn't.
You got any feedback from the business community down there, Susan?
Haven't heard much. They went to the task force there and got some pretty good feedback.
Okay. Commissioners, I tell you, I'm moving with MetroNet. I think the citizens of our great city are getting ripped off with only one-stop shopping, i.e. Cox Communication, for cable TV, telephone, and internet access. When average citizens are limited to one choice, a monopoly choice, the probability is we're not getting the best pricing. So I think a little bit of competition is good. Come on, MetroNet. I guess you know which way I'm going. Any questions at this point, commissioners? Hard to believe that all the towers we see around here, Susan, for other communicators, they only going to need one for the entire city.
Maybe that's
an indication of the advancement of technology too.
And I don't know if they're co-locating, and they're working with other existing. So,
in any case, I welcome the introduction of. Cable TV, internet, telephone, competition. Any question or comment, commissioners? Thank you, Susan. We're with Mr. Brennan now on to West 570, West Ocean View, LLC.
Yep, so this is a conditional use permit to operate an 8-unit apartment building as a short-term rental. It's on West Ocean View between 5th View Street and 6th View Street. Next slide, please, Sherry. So it's in the RC district and the CRO. In the RC district, any multifamily building with more than 3 units requires a conditional use permit. This is an 8-unit apartment building, so they're requesting the conditional use permit to operate all 8 units as short-term rental units. Next slide. So this is the site layout. As you can see, it's right on Ocean View, and as it currently sits, pulling in and out of that parking area is very difficult. There's 3 curb cuts. The parking is straight on, and when I drove to the site myself, I do think I went over one of those curbs trying to back out onto Ocean View because there were some other cars there making it a little difficult. So part of the reason why I show you this because we're going to be addressing this with the site improvements. Next slide, Sherry. So as part of this application, the applicant is redesigning the parking lot to have 60-degree angled parking, and he's also going to be planting 2 trees in that front section there. You can see it's all farther to the right on the slide. When I went on site, we also went into the backyard and saw that it was just a solid block of concrete. So he's going to be removing 2 5x5 sections of concrete and planting native trees. They're all going to be the live oak or loll-bolly pine, as recommended by Stefan Zarek, our landscape architect. He's going to be installing a dune protection fence and a sign reminding his guests to stay off the dunes and stay on the path that's created. And he's also going to be enclosing the trash cans to shield them from right-of-way view. I'll stop here if there are any questions. I know that this is a big site improvement we're getting here.
What's happening actually on West Ocean View Avenue with those curb cuts? Are they to remain or?
They're going to be removed, sir.
I got you. Okay.
And the whole apron is going to be repoured.
Okay. Dr. Austin, I thought you had another question.
Yeah. How many other short-term rentals are near this particular site?
That is, I believe, on the next slide, right, Sherry?
Oh.
I believe when I counted them.
Excuse me.
Bless you, Susan. I think there's somewhere around 25. The exact number is in the staff report. I will look it up again before the public hearing. Most of these are registered voluntarily, and there's only one other one that's registered within a mile by conditional use permit. Obviously, we can see a little bit of clustering here as you get further into the Willoughby neighborhood, but there's not as many as we've seen in some other applications recently.
So I'm a bit confused as to exactly how much mileage we're looking at here. You say there's not another one within a mile or so?
No, there's about, it looks like there's about 25 within a 1 mile radius.
I think what he was saying, not with a conditional use permit. So all the other ones were just, all the purple ones that you see are registered. You can see just off to the left of that circle, there's a two more that we did a conditional use permit for. But this is the only one within that area that we've done a CUP for.
Right.
Well, we know that this is a resort area and whatnot. It's a large cluster of short-term rentals. Where are we in our thinking about this at this point?
It has been difficult to get accurate data determining how these short-term rentals might be affecting the housing market, the availability of rental units and stuff like that, partly because, this has only been a trend since 2016, 2017, and also because of the pandemic, you had major changes in the tourism industry. You know, a lot of Airbnbs were closed right when the pandemic opened, because no one was traveling anywhere. Then you started to see a swing where people didn't want to stay in hotels and wanted to stay in Airbnbs. We just don't have the data at this point to analyze the total effect that they might be having on the market. And if we did, it's likely that COVID would be a significant factor in that data. So it's hard to get a full picture of in a normal time.
And just following up exactly on what Rob was saying, we met with the assessor's office and kind of put this on the radar for them, because I don't think it was something they were tracking. So I think it is on their radar now, and they are looking at various ways they could potentially track it to hopefully give us some information in the future.
Yeah, it does appear that we're at a tipping point, perhaps, in terms of how many of these things are popping up. So it would be useful to really get a handle on what's going on.
And I think the thing to remember, too, is even with the registration, it's only good for 2 years. So I think we might get a lot of initial requests, and then depending on how they do, we might not see them again. So I think we'll get a flurry a lot in the beginning, and perhaps they will go down as we move forward, but time will tell, I guess.
So you're saying, Susan, that a lot of those who gotten CUPs in the past might be dissatisfied with utilizing that property as a short-term rental and not utilize it that way going forward.
And even the registrations.
I think Dr. Austin makes a point. My trepidation has been high. To say we're at the tipping point is in my mind, in many ways, an understatement. Don't know how long it takes for neighborhood character to be disrupted by these types of things. I guess the fortunate thing for us is we have CUPs. And that gives both us, as well as those who have the CUPs, the opportunity to determine whether or not they want to continue after a period of time. So, but I think, Rob, it is critically important that we continue to monitor this. Haven't seen this map before. I'm not as shocked now as I was last time I saw it, but it's obviously growing, and certainly we want to make sure that we try to do the best we can to make sure that we don't unsettle these neighborhoods. Have we gotten any feedback, Rob, from any of the neighborhoods in recent past about these short-term rentals?
So Willoughby did support this one. The applicant said that Willoughby supported this one. He met with them on October 14th. I received a voicemail of opposition from a neighbor. I believe I upload that was included as an attachment to the staff report and should be on Dropbox. In general, we don't have as many issues with the registered ones and the ones that obtain CUPs. And most of the concerns have been to try to get better enforcement. And we think that the recommendations that we're making standard now are going to help with that.
Okay, thank you, Rob. Any other questions on this particular one? We're on the 9567 16th Bay, Rob.
Yeah, we do have slides on the enforcement, but I will go over those in a little more detail during the during the public hearing.
Thank you.
So the next two items are across the street from each other. This is 9567 16th Bay Street. They're both south of Pleasant Avenue, north of Little Creek. They're about five blocks west of Shore Drive. They're currently an apartment, and this is a Tesseract property, and they're looking to operate the building as a short-term rental. Slide, please. So we're still in the RC district, but this is in East Ocean View, still within the coastal residence overlay. So as in with the last one, they need a conditional use permit because they have six units, and anything in the RC district with more than three units requires that conditional use permit. Next slide. So you can see on the bottom there, that is a picture of the site. The applicant is doing a number of exterior renovations as well, facelifts, you could say. But I didn't really get a good picture of that. I believe that was included as part of their application, though, some of those images. In addition, we're going to have them repair the driveway apron. As you can see on the bottom right part of that, sorry, it might be a little tough to see. There's definitely some ponding there on the right. And there's you can see that there's areas where people have driven over the grass in a way to pull into that. In addition, they're going to be putting a 4 foot by 50 foot section of planting there. That image is outdated. They're going to be removing the concrete in that area and planting with native species as recommended by the landscape architect. Next slide, please, Sherry. So this is an image of the nearby short-term rentals. Again, not as much as we had seen in our previous, as last month, I believe it was the one in November had a lot of them, but there still are a number of short-term rentals in this area. So I'm trying to pull up the exact number. It's around here somewhere. There are 44 short-term rentals within the 1 mile radius.
Thanks, Rob. And did I hear you say that both item 7 and 8 are Tesseract properties?
Yes, sir.
Any questions, commissioners? Richmond Wholesale Deals, I guess that's Ms. Kirsch Kelly.
Yes, sir. So the next two, like you said, are mine, and they are very similar to both Rob's. And I'm just going to wait for the slide to come up for Richmond Wholesale. Or is this the next one, Sherry?
This is the next one, but they're almost identical.
Yeah. There we go. Okay, great.
And their improvements and stuff, too.
Did you want to go over your second one, Rob?
Go ahead, Joy.
Okay, so Richmond Wholesale Deals, there's two in a row. I'll try to kind of capture them both at the same time. They're also very similar to Rob's, and these two are also very similar to each other. Next slide, please. Both are obviously multifamily apartment complexes. Both have six apartments. Each apartment are two bedrooms, so that will make for 12 bedrooms for total maximum overnight guests of 24 if this is approved as a short-term rental. Next slide, please. So we did a lotting analysis for this property and also the other short-term rentals. I believe they're in your staff reports. For the two Richmond Wholesale properties, there is a slight majority, 54%, of single family homes surrounding both of these sites. But it's not, it's a marginal majority. Of the 16 homes of the single family homes that surround this property, which is on 15th Bay Street, 16 of those were built after 2000, which tells us, and all those homes that were built after 2000 either replaced empty lots or other single family homes, which tells us that while there is an emerging pattern of new single family homes being built there, there's no indication that these smaller multifamily structures in this coastal area are being redeveloped or replaced with single family homes. Therefore, the use of the property as a short term rental will not necessarily result in the change of development from multifamily for this property. And in a sense, will be in line with the predominant development pattern. Next slide, please. Oh, I'm sorry. Can we go back? I forgot to talk about the site improvements. We've got some nice landscaping up in the front, and of course, all the other security requirements that will be required for all the other short-term rentals will be required here, including a security camera facing the parking lot. And as you can see, the drive apron for this particular property also has some pooling issues, so we're going to require that they replace the drive apron to help clear up that the pooling issues. Now, there are tenants currently in both this site and the next site. Next slide, please. Here we see it's a mix of the neighborhood, mix of both single family and multifamily. And that is that concludes my report for this particular property.
Joy, how far is that location actually from the beach?
Sherry,
go back to the first slide,
please?
Sherry.
Yeah. One more up.
The beach.
I'm sorry, one more down. There you go. As you can see, at the very top there, you've got the Bayside Avenue, and I think just beyond that is.
Thank you, Joy. Any questions, Joy?
Now, in the public hearing slide, we will see the other short-term rentals within a 1 mile radius. However, with Rob's slide, his property is not that far from this one. You get a general sense of how many other short-term rentals are nearby.
And what's the staff recommendation on that?
Approval.
Okay.
Next, I think I get the sense we can move on to the next one. So this is the other one. Now this one's on 14th Bay Street. Again, six unit apartment. Total maximum number of guests will be 24 because they're all two bedrooms. Same analysis, lotting analysis as our previous one. There's a slight majority of single family homes, but it is slight. And the 14 of those homes were built after 2000, and those homes primarily replaced either other single family homes or empty lots. Next slide, please. Here we see again, zone RC. Next slide, please. And this is the property. Again, we've got a little bit more opportunity for some landscaping along the side, along the front of the building, and then along the front between the right-of-way and the parking. And then, of course, here, too, we have a little bit of pooling issues, so we're requesting improvements on the drive apron.
Joy, are all of those units used as short-term or some of those permanent rooms?
Right now, they're permanent. They're ordinary rentals. Both of the Richmond Hotel properties, they do currently have tenants, which they are planning on phasing out.
Joy, we're looking at the back of the building we're talking about, correct? Because looking from the map to this, the house fronts the street, and this is the back of it for parking.
Well, It's the side that faces 14th Bay Street. The entry points are along the side of the multifamily unit. Many of the multifamily units built in here would have side entry points. And then the face side that faces the right-of-way would be a plain side of the building. Did that answer your question?
Not really.
Ms. Austin, if you look at the picture on the left, that gray structure there, that's the building. And you can see the parking, so to speak, in front of the building. But there's other housing on the other side of that building. So it's not really the back.
It's not the back
the
of the structure?
For the apartment complex.
No. It's the side.
The entry points for this, is on the side.
The entry, because what I'm looking at are two buildings on the side of a building in the middle that there's a parking lot that you're entering from the street. And to get into that building, you either have to go around the side and it's on the side, or you go around the side to the front. But on the other side are two other buildings that have nothing to do with that lot. That's what it looks
correct.
Like. That's what it is.
Correct. The blue or gray structure is the subject property itself. The other two are the single family homes to the left and to the right of it.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions, Joy, at this point, commissioners? Joy, it looks like you got a dirty buffalo as well.
Yes, sir. So give me a minute here. So Dirty Buffalo, this is a conditional use permit that would allow the existing restaurant to modify their floor plans for a maximum occupancy of 225 and reduce the number of arcade games from 12 to 8. No other changes are proposed, including the hours of operation. Next slide, please. As you can see, the property is zoned community commercial. In 2016, a special exception, now called a conditional use permit for a restaurant with extended hours and commercial recreation center, was granted for the Dirty Buffalo. Under CC zoning, restaurants with extended hours are required to obtain a CUP. And also, if you're going to have four or more recreation games, of amusement, including video games, you also must obtain a CUP. Because their original CUP was tied to their floor plan and they have changed their floor plan, we are here today. Next slide, please. As you can see, the hours are the same. There was no entertainment requested in 2016. They're still not requesting any entertainment. Really, the only changes are the floor plan, which will allow them to have more capacity. Next slide. Here you see the Dirty Buffalo itself. And then next slide. Here we see a comparison of the 2016 versus the current floor plan of the Dirty Buffalo. And the next slide, please. See a slice of the neighborhood. It's a mix of up along Collie Avenue is commercial, and then behind the Dirty Buffalo is residential. And then that last slide that shows us one half mile radius of all the other ABC establishments. I'm available for questions.
All those establishments within that circumference, they stay open to 2?
I'm sorry, can you repeat that?
No, they just have alcohol. It's other restaurants.
All right. Susan, and while you're talking, we're referring to this place, it stays open at 2, we're referring to it as a restaurant. Shouldn't that be a nightclub?
No, they don't have entertainment.
That answers that question. Thank you, Susan. That's the determinant. Thank you. Any other questions? Joy, I think we're down to DJ Event Center.
Yes, sir. Okay. So this conditional use permit will allow a new DJ training center to have live performances that are open to the public. Next slide, please. As you can see from this slide, it is zone IL, and it is pretty far away from any residential district. During the day, and I do apologize for, never mind. Anyways, during the day, he will be operating the site as a training center, which is allowed under IL zoning. However, if he's going to open up the venue to for live entertainment, then he is required to obtain a CUP. Next slide, please. Here we see a image of the property. His bay is the closest to you, the one on the end, the one that's closer. Yeah, it's the one on the end, closer to you, the photograph. And then you see a picture of the lot. Performers will be restricted to just the students in his classes. He is planning on charging for the performances to help pay for operational costs. He does have a security plan, which in that plan it includes that they will limit re-entry during events. They will monitor for crowd control and ban alcohol. So there won't be any alcohol, weapons, and illegal substances on the premises. And they will also be monitoring the parking area as well. The hours of operation that he's recommend or that he's requesting are for the schoolhouse itself is 11 a.m. to 5 p.m. daily. For hours of operation for live entertainment are 7 p.m. until 10 p.m. Monday through Thursday, 8 p.m. until 12 a.m. Friday and Saturday, and 8 p.m. until 11 p.m. Sunday. Next slide, please. Here we see, as you can see, it's a pretty heavy commercial industrial neighborhood, or that segment of the area is, anyways.
Joy, in that building adjacent to where they're, I think they're going, there is a dance school.
Yes.
I forget the name of it, but they're usually there evenings during the week, predominantly little girls. Does anyone foresee or pretend that that projects a problem? I guess by my saying that, I think I do, huh?
It has not come up until this moment.
Well, hey, Joy, correct me if I'm wrong. When we looked who had a business license to operate at that site, it was only the dry cleaner.
That is true.
So if there's a school there, we don't know about it.
I can tell you there is a school there. You know about that.
So this is the applicant who was going to have guest DJs serve as instructors, but the guest DJs will not perform, correct?
We have put that as a condition of approval, correct.
They're going to stay open till 10 or midnight and charge for admission, presumably to pay to see student DJs perform or spin?
Correct.
And Joy, they changed their hours, right? What?
10 p.m. Monday through Thursday, 12 or midnight Friday and Saturday, 11 on Sunday.
Because remember, initially they wanted till, was it 1? And then we talked to them about it and they reduced their hours.
I just have trouble getting my mind around people paying to see students perform when there are real DJs in the house. But that's just me.
Did the School of Rock charge for their performances? I mean, I know I paid to go there, but it was always for like fundraisers or something. Did they charge for their performances when they were downtown?
You know, I don't know, Kathy. We'd have to check. We would have mentioned that in the staff report.
Sounds like.
Well, I would just think they have. I know School of Rock tickets. You had to have tickets to get in because that's an occupancy thing. So, but I don't know if they charge for the tickets or.
Gotcha.
I'm just trying to understand. It seems very similar to School of Rock, but it's Kevin said, but at School of Rock the instructors did perform with the kids, so that's a little bit different.
Gotcha.
Okay,
what's going to be the capacity in there, Joy?
Capacity for seats indoors, 116. Total capacity for 130.
And he can't pull, or let me ask this, can he pull an ABC license if he wanted to for a special event like School of Rock used to do, or will the CUP not allow him to pull a special ABC license for like a fundraiser or something? Okay.
We're recommending no alcohol.
Okay.
Yeah, there's a condition that says no alcohol.
Okay. I just want to clarify and make sure I understood that he couldn't just do a one-off like for fundraisers. Excellent. Thank you.
Just to kind of give you a sense about how archaic I am, I can't get my mind around a DJ school. Are you kidding me? Okay.
That's where the money is, Earl. Forget performing live music, man. DJs make more money than bands do now. A lot more money than bands do.
Well, I was going to jump in as an old relic from the hip hop era in the early days. I would certainly pay to hear new DJs, and to even if the experienced and maybe more famous DJs were in attendance, I would hear them speak if they wanted to talk about maybe some of their past experiences. So this makes perfect sense to me.
I hear you. I'll catch up, Kim. I'll catch up. Give me time.
Economic diversity. People have to make it how they can. I have a question, just a question of staff. In this one shot here on Alabama Avenue, we see pooling, and it looks like there's been parking and that there was actually no curb, and that's one of the reasons why there's pooling there. And we've seen that on previous properties that we were looking at for short-term rentals. Is staff talking about measures to prevent that kind of pooling happening?
So the pooling that you see in that photograph is not actually on the applicant's site.
Right.
I know that, but it was on an applicant's site before. And it's like, what measures are we asking them to take? Because obviously cars are going over areas that have no curb and are just grass or dirt. And then when it rains, that pools. And it, sort of goes out all over this that side of the street. So are we asking them to do some type of landscaping or to put, or are we putting in a curb or what to prevent that from happening?
So Ramona, with the short-term rentals, which is what you're talking about, on almost every one, they're replacing the apron, which is part of the reason it probably wasn't installed properly. And then also on several of them, we are putting landscaping up front, which both of those should help.
Great. And I guess with something like this, sooner or later, the city's gonna get to it. You know, it'll come up in some way, somehow, and we can make this circumstance better.
Joy.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm not an engineer. I don't really have an answer for that. But if we see it, we do try to make it as a condition of approval. I apologize.
Not a problem.
Let me jump in here, Mr. Chair. Every one of these applications is reviewed by all of our reviewing departments, whether it's Public Works and Utilities, Transit, all of those folks. So if there are known problems, they typically catch them and recommend to us fixes. You know, this is not something that's done in a vacuum. All of the only ones that our department, all of them get to see. So, you know, the issue, of course, with stormwater is that it's never a simple solution. And it's really hard to do one little thing and affect the solution to a problem, because problems generally caused by a confluence of many different things. We do, whenever possible, try to get fixes to infrastructure that is failing or could be improved. And I know that's one of the things that frustrates applicants sometimes. They think that, you know, they're being tasked with doing what the city should have been doing. You all occasionally hear that, but that's, you know, that is our basic, you know, philosophy. It's that every one of these, we try to improve both the site and the immediately adjacent infrastructure if it needs it. I don't know if that helps, Dr. Austin, but that's the best answer.
It helps a lot because this leads to the deterioration of the road, which leads to deterioration of vehicles. As you said, it just goes on and on. It's great to know that everybody's looking at it.
Yeah, that's been a standard practice. We appreciate that update on that, Joy. A reminder, if you will. Joy, where are all these folks going to DJ school going to park, particularly when they have their test at 9:30 on a Friday night? And the teaching DJ wants to see how much energy they can generate amongst 120 people. Where are those folks going to park?
Well, the DJ school itself, for the under, if we can scroll up, please. There we go. So here we've got a parking layout for the site. I believe there's 13 spaces on the site itself. And the applicant has informed me that he is working on obtaining a parking agreement with an adjacent property, although unfortunately that agreement wasn't procured by the time by today. Which will also render additional 4 more spaces. The DJ school itself, that's what I have to offer for this site. We do anticipate that the other uses will be closed during the time that the DJ public events will be on.
Well, I certainly would be curious. I hope the applicant is there. We can ask that question then. But it seems to me that on Friday nights, when the students are probably testing what they learned all week, you're likely to have a crowd of people there, and that could generate a lot of motor vehicles. That could be somewhat problematic when you look at the limited availability of parking in that general area. I can tell you, I have 2 granddaughters that are alums of the adjacent dancing school, and that parking lot on the side on any Thursday evening, you're lucky it's packed. So it seems to me that if you got DJ school and you got dancing school, in the evenings, sure, when the cleaners is operating during the day, that's not a problem. But you're looking at close to 130, 160 people. That could be a huge parking nightmare in that particular location on Friday or any night. There is no on street parking down on the Ingleside. But in any case, are there any other questions of Joy at this point with regard to DJ Event Center? And maybe if I get started now, Kim, I can grow up to be Kid Capri, huh?
There's always hope, Mr. Fraley. Always hope.
Your second career.
You might be able to take classes, Earl.
Yeah. I only say Kid Capri because I had occasion to meet him one time. So.
You just let me know. I'll leave my Friday nights open if you're going to do that.
This is getting too deep already. Okay. Architecture review board items. Are we through with that one? Anyone have any questions or comments? Okay. We're on the architecture review board items. 115 West 25th Street.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
McBride?
Yes.
Hello, Susan.
Hi. This is it's a light industrial. The arrow is pointing to the suite. I couldn't get the front of this building, but it's suite A. This is the building. It's been renovated. This is a design review application for business sign encroachment. This is one of those buildings that's in both the Park Place and the industrial Norfolk and Western District. It's just a blade sign encroachment, as you can see from the top here. It's for Sky's the Limit Yoga, right above the door. It's only going to say yoga. It's projecting, as you can see, just over the property line there. And this is what it would look like if you were looking at it straight on from the street. And ARB recommended the application as presented unanimously. The next one is on the same building on the Omohundro side, and the arrow is pointing to Suite F there, as you can see, and the same location. It's a nice looking renovation that they've done, not in the historic overlay. They want a blade sign encroachment as well as a ABC rail for outdoor dining. The seating all the way to the left is for the neighboring. Here's what it would look like if you were looking at it from the street. This is the furnishings for the proposed encroachment, and the sign, Mikasa. It's the restaurant. What's interesting is that, as you can see in the upper left-hand corner, and the bottom right-hand corner, the existing railing there is, I believe it's Fish and Pig next door, and they're going to use the same furniture and the same railing. So, again, the ARB unanimously recommend the application for approval as presented. And then we have another sign for the Chelsea neighborhood. It's on city-owned property, not an encroachment. Please ignore the number over on the left that I don't know how that ended up. And so here's the survey. They want it kind of at an angle at the corner. I believe that's the Elizabeth River Trail, maybe.
Yeah.
Draining around the corner there. And here's a view from the street. So people get a nice view as they come around. There's some public art here on this site too, I'm told. And they want it in kind of a, excuse me, a script. There's no landscaping coming through at this time. That will come through at a later date. And, this is a photo sim of what you would see if you go by. In option one, they want option two is their preferred option, which I believe is only changing the angle at which it would be seen out there. And the ARB also unanimously recommends approval for option two as submitted for the sign.
Thank you, Ms. McBride. Any questions on any of those ARB items, commissioners? Comment, criticism, suggestion? Thank you, Susan.
Thank you.
And the last new business items, folks, will be the adoption of our 2022 CPC schedule. Anybody have any question or comment on that at this point? Hearing none, we are back to an agenda item with Mr. Homewood.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the commission. I apologize to you a little bit. All of a sudden, I've just started getting this drainage down the back of my throat. So hopefully I will make it all the way through all this, and I'm not quite sure what's up and why. I got to admit, you know, we're all sort of acknowledging age and things that we did in our misspent youth. And, I did spend some time as a DJ, but it was back in the day when it was the music that was actually the reason that folks were there. And it's the music that was the center of attention, not the person spinning the tunes, spinning the little vinyl discs. I'm not sure I would survive in today's version of what DJs do.
I'm trying my best to get a visual of that, George.
I was going to say, if there's photographic evidence, I'd like that, please. Put it on a slide for the next meeting, please. Thank you.
You know, I'm pretty sure that the daguerreotypes or whatever you know, back from those days, you know, wouldn't capture, you know, you had to stand still for so long. And probably no photographic evidence, at least I hope not. I want to make absolutely sure, Ms. Chairman, I know you asked, but is everybody okay with the calendar? I know I've asked this several times. We're going to adopt it. And you know, once it gets adopted, it kind of goes on autopilot. You know, it is nigh on impossible to make changes to it. So just please confirm that everybody's okay. All right. Seeing most of those heads going north and south. We've had an eventful couple of weeks at City Council. We had two of the use permits that you all have issued that were for which revocation was being requested. City Council did revoke the CUP for Origami, the proprietors of Culture, which is the Grand Street Neon District. I think the mayor, I believe, negotiated a settlement where they gave up their CUP that allowed them to operate a nightclub so that they could convert to a restaurant, and, which Susan has been working on since Tuesday night. So essentially two nightclubs have been shuttered. To the point, Mr. Chairman, you raised earlier, you know, a nightclub is an establishment that has entertainment, it has a dance floor, it has ABC, and it has laid outs.
Right.
You've got to have all those to be a nightclub.
Right.
But if it does have all those, it is a nightclub.
Right.
You know, and of course, we require these places to serve food. They have a menu. I'm not familiar because I'm of that age where I'm no longer up at 2 o'clock in the morning. I really can't tell you how much of a menu and food selection is actually being provided past many restaurants. You know, remember that any place with our new zoning ordinance, any place can be a restaurant. As long as they stay in the box of performance standards, as a matter of right. So you can be a restaurant, you can have alcohol sales, as long as you close by midnight in downtown and 10 or 11 elsewhere in the city. It's only if you want to go past those hours or add entertainment that you have to come and get a conditional use permit. I just throw that out to you because I'm going to come back to this conversation as soon as I finish talking about the rest of my council that's done. I'm going to come back and dive into that just a little bit. So I believe, and Adam will correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe that council now has finally addressed every single thing that has come through Planning Commission this year up until today. As far as I know, it used to be there were two things that were hanging out there that council had never addressed, one of which was the hotel restaurant site on Northampton, but that application became moot when it was approved multifamily. And then the other one is that text amendment that still has not been taken off the table for that dealt with Dollar Shores. Other than that, I think now council has addressed every item that has dealt with up through today. So,
George, if I could, I apologize for interjecting. This is Paula. I do have a delinquent item. We have the right-of-way vacations for Ohio Creek.
That's right. Yes. That one street closure. I keep forgetting, you know, somehow those just don't seem like planning applications at all. You know, seem like that should be some other department. just say. In any case, so all of the St. Paul's that you all addressed was approved. The PRG community development for Willis Bowling site, that was approved. And thanks to Adam, I think we have got an answer for truck delivery to Norfolk Wholesale Floral. And we worked through that. So that's all good news. The EDC and the Pensio from last meeting approved. Royal Farms was approved, as you recommended, without vaping products. The attorney for Royal Farms withdrew their request for the sale of vaping products before the council. One that went through on Tuesday night that did not quite come out the way you all recommended was live entertainment restaurant with extended hours on Granby Street, 255, called Prime 255. If you all recall, we had the staff had recommended, as Planning Commission agreed, that this establishment should not be allowed to operate past midnight out of the gate. That the idea of staying within the 12 midnight time frame and for a year and showing that you can operate your business without creating negative externality problems to the community, and then come back and ask for extended out. Council decided to grant the extended hours. And two things, I guess, are probably, in my mind, relevant. One is that, as all of you, I think, remember, this was essentially a business that had already been approved earlier this year, although not ever opened and established. And there was a change of ownership and management and name that caused it to come back through the process. And of course, what happened between the time it was approved in early 2021 and when it started back in the process was we have become aware of increasing problems in the Neon District, increasing problems on Granby Street, and particularly increasing problems from midnight till 2-3. And as a result, we had heard from the Downtown Norfolk Council, we've heard from the Downtown Norfolk Civic League, we've heard from others that we really needed to think long and hard about the approval process. So back in October, Chief Goldsmith, who is the deputy city manager who oversees public safety components, so the former police chief, had briefed council and indicated that we were, as a city, going to establish a policy of not granting extended hours on the first application somebody coming to the city asking for and that essentially limit up to normal hours, and then after a year they could come back and extended hours, and then they have track record upon which that decision would be based, not all of this, supposing what could happen and based on promises and suppositions. So we applied that principle to Prime 255 and recommended not having those out. Council, I will say, took me to task a little bit for that recommendation. As I mentioned, they went ahead and approved the 2 a.m. closing for Friday night and Saturday, which is what the application. And so the conversation I really want to have with y'all today and I'm glad we do have an extra few minutes to have that conversation, is whether or not y'all are on board with this idea that a brand new, untested, untried establishment proposing entertainment ABC and late hours maybe doesn't get those late hours on that their first application in the building. What we know, all the evidence shows, is that the problems we are having are happening in the early hours of the morning. Not happening so much, they're certainly not happening before 10, generally not happening before 10 p.m. And really start ramping up. And that's that. Based on that, those data points, that's why the suggestion is to give people an opportunity to prove themselves, build the track record of being a positive force in the community before asking to, for those hours that are the hours that are getting people in trouble. So I throw that out, and I really would like to hear from y'all whether or not you think that's appropriate, because I kind of got told on Tuesday that some members of council do not think that's appropriate. So I just want to hear from y'all, because we have several coming up in January. This conversation is going to be very relevant. So, Mr. Chairman, I kind of toss the ball back to you and to the members of the commission, so maybe we can have a little bit of a conversation.
Appreciate that, George. So is council saying, in your view, that they would rather have these folks come in, and if they're asking for 2 o'clock the first time, give them the 2 o'clock, as opposed to holding them back for 2 years?
Well, we never talked about holding them back for 2 years. We told them, we talked about a 1 year, delay, build a track record for a year. Now, I mean, if in the first year, you've got, 40 police calls for service, then maybe the recommendation would be to extend the hours. But yeah, I got the sense. I mean, Adam and Susan were both in the room with me on Tuesday night. I'll let either of them jump in and talk, but my sense was that, there was a strong feeling that whatever an applicant asks for, that's what needs to be forwarded to council, not something different.
Well, it certainly eliminates a variable for us, doesn't it? I mean, if we know that they won't approve it, we don't have to consider it.
Well, and I guess we can still vote.
Everything else we do, where we make recommendations for, infrastructure improvements and site improvements and all kinds of other things. So I just.
Go ahead, Dr. Austin. Were you about to say something?
Just going to say, if it's been our experience and we have been voting this way because of that experience, and I think we should vote as we feel. And if they wish to do override it, so be it.
That was sort of looking at that as well, trying to negotiate what you think they may want. Staff trying to do that might be harder than just bringing to us and we voted. And if they ended up overturning us for voting something down that we would have voted for if the hours had been different, I mean, just like we would if it was a more landscaping or a curb cut or whatever, if that's the responsibility they want to take on having the civic leagues and the business associations show up, that we voted with them. And again, I'm not saying that we would. I don't know how that would work out. But I mean, I guess the thing is they can ask for it and we vote and then they vote. Which is messier, publicly messier, but it is what it is.
Yeah, I agree with you there, Kathy. It is probably a little messier. And we have to remember, we are an advisory body to the city council. And we have to use our considered judgment to submit that advice to council. they don't like it, they can, as they always have the prerogative to do, they can change it. I just give some pause. I keep hearing about this restaurant and entertainment to 2 a.m. Who eats at 2 a.m.?
Well, I mean, I think, and George or Susan, someone remind me, where in the city can you have a nightclub or entertainment in every commercial area of the city? So could you have one in Ward's Corner, Ghent, anywhere there's a commercial, a restaurant, potentially, could there be a nightclub there?
Yes, I believe so.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, the way we wrote it is, so the restaurant is the base use. And then you can add on things to that base use. Entertainment, late night.
Well, except for we do have a definition. We do have a use called nightclub.
Right, we do. But
okay, so here's what I'm going to say, just again, looking in my crystal ball and using my development experience as a background. As retail continues to die, as leases continue to go away, this use is going to proliferate throughout the city. The people asking for this kind of uses, this kind of entertainment use, is going to proliferate throughout the city because that's where the market's going to go. People might order from Amazon, but you can't order your nightclub from Amazon. You can't order that experience. People are in desperate desire to have these kinds of experiences because of what we've gone through the last 2 years and maybe be going through for another year. But we're going to be faced with this not just in downtown. We're going to get faced with this over and over in other areas of the city, in my opinion. And so what we do now and what they do now is going to be some predictor of that. And it's not just going to be where they're deciding on it in downtown, where most of their constituents do not live. They're going to be deciding on this thing throughout the city. That's what I believe. So they may change their mind when that's happening. So I don't know that. And I'll spend my time ever how you all want me to spend it, but I don't know that we spending a lot of time on thinking about this right now is going to help us going forward. You know, maybe we send a few of these on to council in the way that they were given to us, whether we voted up or down, and then see how that goes. Because I think you're going to start seeing it around the city because property has to be used for something for those property owners to make money, and it's not going to be for retail. And so you're going to see more and more of this kind of thing, I think. And for restaurants to make money, they're going to have to start staying open later and have alcohol and entertainment to compete with other restaurants that have alcohol and entertainment. So I'm not saying it's going to be 100 at once, but I'm saying over the next 2 years, I think you're going to see it proliferate across the city. So,
George, if we're looking at this trial period, stay open at 12 for a year and see how you do. And if you want to go to two, come back to us. What about a national chain that has a history around the country, state, commonwealth, region, if you will, of staying open at 2 o'clock and they come to our city with a first time opportunity and they want to stay open at two, but they've never been here before. And we recommend, we want you to stay to 12. Doesn't that create a dichotomy of sorts? I mean, their track record in other cities is probably as indicative of how they're going to perform here as anything else, wouldn't you think?
Well, I mean, I guess, first of all, I'm trying to think of a national chain that has
a bar chain,
night hours and entertainment. But absent that, I mean, obviously, I mean, this is the reason that a conditional use permit is considered and on a case-by-case basis. And that everybody gets the chance to reflect upon the specifics of the application, and indeed the specifics of the applicant, in the case of ABC establishments, and make a decision. We're not talking about we've never talked about writing this into the ordinance and say this is ordinance language. But we talked about creating it as a policy. As we all know, things that are policy can, if for good cause shown, we can make a policy. We might want to tell some people, I'm sorry, you're worrisome enough that you close at 10 p.m. For a year and show us that you actually can make this thing work before coming back to operate. I don't know. I'm just you know, I'm just doing some for instance here. I can't think of a national chain.
That stays open to 2 a.m. Neither can I, but I was just a hypothetical, if you will.
I mean, I think Buffalo Wild Wings stays open until 2 a.m., but it, I mean, they're not an entertainment establishment. I mean, it probably qualifies as a commercial rec center with all the machines they've got now on all the tables, but, you know, it's not something that be concerned about as calling it, you know, as something that has entertainment.
There's always the notion of considering every application as it comes before us and making a recommendation based on the details within the application. Any other comments?
I would say a case-by-case basis is best. And apropos of what Kathy has said, think of a proliferation of short-term rentals and a proliferation of nightclubs. I mean, what a combination. It's to think about, not, you know, just as something that could happen down the line. And do we, as an advisory board, sort of act as a gentle, consideration of this, just so that it's in front of us and we don't ignore it?
Any others?
I just want to say, like I'm trying to think through this, and I may contradict myself next month. So, because I think we have to think through it more, but I just do want to be careful when we talk about policies, because you know policies, we have to make sure they're implemented across the board fairly. With the way the CUP is now, I think it's fair because it is case by case. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just if you know we have instances where we might have a bar restaurant with entertainment come to us. I mean, we've had this in the last few months where we had the people that, and I apologize for not remembering the names of the establishments, but I believe that the establishment for Plume Street near Mr. Brothers restaurant came to us on the same public hearing as the Brews and Barbecue place, which I think maybe they don't have entertainment, but I thought they could off of Hampton Boulevard. And I just want to make sure that we are both, if there's new owners and it's new and all of that, because I think we're getting a lot of new operators and owners, that we just make sure that we're looking at it, because we have had more problems with downtown and that sort of thing, that we are still looking at it universally across the city. So a case by case kind of works for me on that.
Thanks, Kathy. Any other comment, commissioners? George, this doesn't help you too much, does it?
Well, you know, having a conversation is always helpful.
You're very kind too, George.
Well, getting the ideas out, and so folks are thinking about it, and this can germinate over time, and we can have, you know, more discussions about it as we get close to the January public hearing. I expect we're going to, I mean, I know we have several items on the agenda January, tentatively, but this will be the conversation. Send it out where everybody now has the ability to think about it and not get hit cold with it, you know, in January is probably a really good thing. One thing I'll mention that Mr. Riddick made a comment one of the council meetings last month. The more I think about the comment, the more I realize how the underlying truth in it. And that is, said that where we have gotten to is that people go to town center to get beach to dine, to come to Norfolk to drink. And we need to make sure that whatever we're doing, regardless of where the market wants to push us, we need to make sure that we're not pushing our dining establishments the ones that really are the ones that created that vibrancy on Granby Street, justifiably proud of, we need to make sure we don't push them away, push them out to, hopefully not to town center. Just need to make sure that that's...
Knowing Councilman Riddick as I do, George, I've heard that comment on numerous occasions. I didn't know he would utter it in such public forums, though. But be that as it may, there very well may be some validity to that. In the sense that, think about this. We are a natural harbor, natural maritime city. Very few in our city, local seafood restaurants. Whereas our neighbors in the beach have a plethora of them to choose from. And you're right, Grammy Street went from a mall to a restaurant dining facility. And the same with the nightclub. So that's something to consider in terms of how we present ourselves to the public. And which was one of the reasons I was in favor of the 12 o'clock the first time out. I guess I can understand council's position to a great extent, and in the sense that they want to continue to send a message of being a entrepreneurial friendly city, and these first time operators coming in, certainly entrepreneurs that I'm sure council members would want to welcome.
Mr. Chair, I worry you're overstating the council's approach. There was some discussion at the meeting. I think that's what the mayor said. I think there were other council members that said we should have a policy and we need to talk about it. I don't know what to suggest to you all other than to kind of skip through the video to that point and kind of see how it went down. I did not understand the council as a body to have expressed a preference for
one or the other.
I think they acknowledged maybe they should have debated it a little bit more instead of one or two council people expressing opinions and then staff doing work to try to stay ahead of the game a little bit. So my take was that there is no policy at this point, and it's part of what has put the staff in a difficult position of how to work with applicants to get applications 1-2 months out into a format that is likely to get approved by you all and by council. So it looked like a little more of a debate to me than a policy.
I watched it as well, and they're not, I mean, to me, they're clearly not on the same page, but I don't know that anything we would decide here as far as a policy would get them on the same page as well. Adam, I don't know. I mean, I understand where the position that George and staff are in, and I understand certainly for them, you know, and I appreciate them coming to us to talk about it, but I got the impression they were very divided on this from watching it. So I don't know that anything that we would all agree to would unite them, but I'm perfectly willing to try if it would help out staff.
George, what is staff's position on this?
Well, you know, at the basic level, our position is that the reason that you have a staff, the reason that the city has a planning department, is to provide the best professional advice and recommendations that we can based on experience and knowledge and understanding plans and the future direction, that sort of thing. to both you as a body, as well as to City Council and to other bodies. The fact that our experience is showing us that there's a high probability of problems with a particular type of business under a particular type of scenario, leading us to recommend sort of a prophylactic approach as opposed to a, let's just approve them, and if they're bad, we'll haul them in the boat approach. So that's, I think our staff level, we think this is our job, and appropriately our job, to make the best professional recommendations that we can to you and to council. I learned a long, long time ago that I do not take it personally. Either the planning commission or city council says, well, George, that's your opinion, you're entitled to it, but we don't agree. That's fine. That's your job as well. So I don't take it personally, but if we're heading, we thought we were marching together in a certain direction. And what surprised me on Tuesday was I had a strong sense that not everybody is on board. So that's the reason I wanted to have the conversation with y'all today, to find out whether or not, as a group, more or less, y'all are still on board with that kind of approach. It sounds to me like you are, but you're going to look at them on a case-by-case basis, which is exactly what you should do. And see where the chips fall when it gets to council, recognizing that y'all take the same approach to council as we do. Council is the ultimate decision maker, and if they take the recommendation, great. That's all. Was that a very long way of not answering the question? I don't know. I felt like I rambled a little bit. So.
Well, I think, Commissioner, what we're hearing, I don't know, you folks tell me, we consider these on a case-by-case basis and make a recommendation based on those parameters associated with that application and any affiliated history that may impact any judgment that we may have on that particular applicant or application. I mean, we're talking about whether they should stay open to 2 or whether they should close at 12 for a year.
In other words, continue as we have been doing.
That's what I'm suggesting. Any opposition to that? In a very general sense, commissioners. Matt, I haven't heard from you.
No, I was offline for a minute there, but I'm picking up where you're talking. I'm with you on everything. I apologize. I did go offline for about 10 minutes there.
Any other comment?
I just want to say I do think that it's important, as they've done, as that staff spends the time that they spend with these businesses, and we need to recognize that time when they make their recommendations and understand. I understand what George's position is as far as, the vote goes as the vote goes, but I do think there needs to be some recognition. They're the people who've spent time with these business owners. They're the people who have spent time with civic leagues, and they're the people who can understand some of the surrounding issues. So I'm not saying that it's an automatic whatever they recommend. I'm just saying I think, as we've done before, we definitely need to give credence to the amount of work they put into that.
There's absolutely value in the investigation, no question. That's the basis upon which we make our recommendation. Any other comment? Question, criticism, suggestion, George? You have anything else? I think we got quite some time. Yes.
Well, the only other thing I've got, Mr. Chairman and members of the commission, is that, on behalf of the staff, I want to wish each and every one of you the happiest of holidays. However it is you celebrate them, I hope you manage to celebrate them with family and friends. Because in my mind, that's what holidays are all about, is getting together each of you. Wonderful holiday season. Looking forward to an interesting 2022. Might actually get to spend some time together in 2022. At least hopefully.
Which brings an interesting question, George, and before I say anything further, same to you and your family and the rest of the staff and the commissioners as well for happy holiday season and prosperous new year. Are we intending, or have you gotten any word from higher-ups, George, as to what the plan will be with regard to COVID response going into 2022? Are we still virtual meetings? Are there going to be in-person meetings at any time at all scheduled right now going into 2022?
Well, you know, Adam can probably answer that question better.
I'm not aware of any discussions so far. The permission, the last time the council extended the local permission under its authority that it has now, thanks to some enhancements made by the General Assembly last year, last session, is that I think we're able to do electronic only meetings through March 21st, 23rd, something like that, of 2022. And because that can only be extended by council ordinance, and because you all need to be, you all, staff needs to be advertising for public hearings, such as the one in March, at least 3 weeks before, or probably has to get to the paper a little bit before then. Those, we need to start having those discussions and probably have a decision from council in February. I'm afraid we are going to know more about the extent of the latest wave of this particular variant in the next month or two. So, that's just something we're going to have to put a pin in, that if we're going to extend the ability to have electronic meetings, it needs to be discussed before February so that it can be acted on in February.
So we're going to be meeting virtually at least through February.
So should we put that on a
Amanda, you're breaking up. Dr. Lloyd?
Yeah, we need all after, should we?
Oh, shoot.
Okay, there you are.
You bet. Okay. George, Adam, George, any other comment?
I don't know if Commissioner Lloyd was saying, should we put that on y'all's agenda? That's a bigger issue than just for you all the city boards and commissions that are utilizing electronic meetings, including the council, are going to be implicated by that. So that's a bigger question than just this one. So it's going to, somebody will be attending to it so that we can get a decision from them in time in February for everybody to be on board with what we're doing after March 23rd, I think it is.
Yeah, I just see a message from Amanda. She got your feedback on that, Adam.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other comment, commissioners, at this point?
Yeah, Mr. Chair, I have one. I'm sorry. I should have asked earlier. And I've been trading emails with George on this. In the new business section, I say when we get upstairs, when we get up to the virtual upstairs, I'd like to make a motion to initiate a text amendment for the East Beach Special Purpose District. We've got some, there's a lot of stuff going on out here right now around some commercial space and mixed use space and some parking issues. And the bottom line is that the special purpose district was created sort of in a concept 17, 18 years ago, and it really has never been revisited. And I think it's time to take a look at the special purpose district and what does it say versus what we're doing in practice today and make sure they align. There's definitely some disconnects from what's going on in practice versus what is written in the special permit district. So I've talked to George. I know that some folks have talked to Susan and Jeremy on it as well. So it's known that we're doing this, but I thought it'd be to try to get ahead of the curve a little bit is go ahead and just at least put a motion out there to initiate the text amendment so we can get the ball rolling on that, if that's okay with the group.
Yeah, Matt, we've actually been working with both the architect and with Bart Fry on that. They know that they need to make some amendments, so we were kind of waiting for them to come back at us. Either way.
Cool. I'm not sure what they want. I'm a little worried about it, but we'll see how it comes. You know, one hand they want to, you know, limit parking, but the other hand you want commercial in the neighborhood, you know, and you can't have, you know, your cake and eat it too. So it's going to be interesting to see how it comes back. But anyways, I'll probably bring that up in the new business section. Just want to give everyone a heads up on that.
Look forward to it, Matt. Thank you. Any other comment, commissioners? We got about 45 minutes before we reconvene. Please note that is different from the access for this meeting. That is a different access. And if there are no other comment at this point, hopefully everyone will be back with us at 2:30.
Can we try to log in like between 2:15 and 2:20, please? So that everybody's on the call.
So everybody's online. See you then, folks. Thanks so very much.
Thank you.